Hello everyone, myself Dr. Sagarika, Associate Professor in the Department of Critical Care Medicine, IMS Sum Hospital. Today I am going to present a basic physiology topic, that is endothelial glycocalyx and the revised Starling principle. I will be talking about the Starling principle, the revision of Starling principle, role of endothelial glycocalyx and its clinical implications related to its biological functions, damage, regeneration and the strategies to protect the endothelial glycocalyx. Tissue fluid balance, plasma volume regulation and clinical edema formation are governed by the Starling principle of microvascular fluid exchange. This states that the transendothelial filtration is driven by the capillary hydrostatic pressure and the interstitial oncotic pressure, while a counteracting absorptive force is exerted by the plasma oncotic pressure and the interstitial hydrostatic pressure. So the Starling equation states that the fluid flow rate, that is the JV, depends on the net imbalance between the capillary hydrostatic pressure and the interstitial oncotic pressure. We know that the hydrostatic pressure is higher at the arteriolar end of a capillary, and as it reaches the venular end, the hydrostatic pressure gradually decreases. So as this hydrostatic pressure decreases along a capillary from arteriolar end to the venular end, filtration of the plasma fluid into the interstitium occur at the arteriolar end, and reabsorption of the interstitial fluid occur at the venular end. So this is the basis of the traditional Starling principle, which was postulated in 1896. Later, Starling recognized that the interstitial fluid has a substantial amount of plasma protein concentration. So, the microvascular semi-permeability concept is imperfect, and he also recognized that the endothelial barrier slowly leaks the plasma proteins into the interstitium, which was quantified by using the Stavermann's osmotic reflection coefficient, that is sigma. The sigma varies from 0 to 1, where the 1 means 100%, that is no leakage of the solute to the interstitium. So the Starling's equation modified using the sigma. But in 1987, Michel and Philippe found that the capillaries with a low blood pressure can absorb fluid transiently but not in the steady state. So what they observe is that when the capillary hydrostatic pressure increases, the filtration also increases, the filtration rate also increases linearly with the capillary pressure. But when the capillary pressure decreases and it becomes less than the interstitial oncotic pressure, then there occur a transient period of reabsorption, but that reabsorption never occur in a steady state. So this is in contrary to the traditional Starling's absorption filtration model. So this is the filtration absorption model, where at the arteriolar end, where the capillary hydrostatic pressure is higher than the osmotic pressure, so here filtration occur. But at the venular end, where the hydrostatic pressure become less than the oncotic pressure, reabsorption of the fluid occur. But as proposed by Michel and Philippe, and later supported by the Levick's work in 1991, this capillary hydrostatic pressure, as it decreases, the filtration rate also decreases, but absorption of the fluid never occur in a steady state. Now we'll discuss about the endothelial glycocalyx and its role in the revised Starling principle. So endothelial lumen is covered by a protective jelly-like layer, which is known as the glycocalyx. That is, this glycocalyx is a dynamic and a complex biochemical structure consisting of proteoglycan, glycoproteins and glycosaminoglycans. These are the structural components. Along with that, it also contains antithrombin 3, superoxide dismutase, chemokines and growth factors. So this is shown here. This is the endothelial cell and this is the glycocalyx layer, consists of the structural proteins, glycoprotein, proteoglycan and glycosaminoglycan chain. Proteoglycan is considered as the important backbone molecule of endothelial glycocalyx. It consists of core protein to which various components of the glycosaminoglycan are attached. So these core proteins like the syndecan and the glypican, they have a firm connection to the cell membrane. And glycosaminoglycan, they are consist of or made up of heparan sulfate, chondroitin sulfate, keratin sulfate and hyaluronic acid. So it has a specific characteristic that they are negatively charged. So because of this negatively charged, they used to repel the cellular component of the blood, that is the RBC, leukocytes and the platelet. So they used to repel them from the endothelium. And the third component is the glycoprotein. So it forms the endothelial cell adhesion molecule. So this adhesion molecule, they are of usually three family: selectin, integrin and the immunoglobulin family. So selectin, these are the E selectin and P selectin, which are involved in leukocyte and endothelial cell interactions. Integrin bind to the extracellular matrix and responsible for interaction with laminin, fibronectin and the collagen. And in the immunoglobulin family, there are ICAM, VCAM and the PECAM. The biological function of the endothelial glycocalyx is that it is the determinant of the vascular permeability. It influences the blood cell and vessel wall interactions. So because of the negative charge of the glycosaminoglycan layer, they used to repel the blood components from the endothelium and they used to form a RBC platelet or the cellular component exclusion zone at the endothelium. They are also involved in the coagulation, thrombosis and hemostasis pathway. They act as a mechanotransducer, so they are used as a transmission of the shear stress signal using a various signal pathway, for example production of nitric oxide, cytoskeletal reorganization. They also act as a control center of the microenvironment. So various molecules like antithrombin 3, VGF, the lipoprotein lipase, they perform their function by interacting with the endothelial glycocalyx. So how this glycocalyx leads to the revised Starling principle? So the Starling principle, the usual Starling principle was that the capillary wall, they slowly leaks the plasma protein from the lumen to the interstitium. And these plasma protein in the interstitium, they are responsible for the interstitial colloid oncotic pressure. And the fluid movement was determined by the difference between the osmotic barrier, that is difference between the plasma colloid osmotic pressure and the interstitial colloid oncotic pressure. But the glycocalyx model says that, or the new concept is that, these plasma proteins, they get adsorbed into the endothelial glycocalyx layer. So here they are responsible for the formation of the endothelial glycocalyx colloid oncotic pressure, which is indicated by this pi g. And hence, the osmotic barrier for the fluid filtration is determined not by the plasma and the interstitial oncotic pressure, but by the plasma oncotic pressure and the endothelial glycocalyx oncotic pressure. So the revised Starling principle is that glycocalyx is the semi-permeable membrane, not the endothelium. And the effective osmotic barrier is not the whole capillary, it is just the luminal endothelial glycocalyx layer. The oncotic pressure gradient is between the plasma and the sub-glycocalyx space, not the plasma and the interstitial space. So in the revised Starling principle, the effect of interstitial fluid oncotic pressure on the net fluid exchange is minimal. And when the glycocalyx is intact, the net outward movement of the fluid is opposed, but it is not reversed by this oncotic pressure gradient. So no reabsorption occur at the venule. So there is filtration at the arteriolar end, and the filtration gradually decreases, but no reabsorption occur in the venular end. So there are various conditions when the glycocalyx get damaged. So like in case of hyperglycemia, hyperlipidemia, smoking, all these leads to thinning of the glycocalyx layer. And glycocalyx layer shedding also occur during the inflammatory conditions, during sepsis, ischemic reperfusion injury, hypervolemia, and after major vascular surgery. So in sepsis, the inflammatory markers, the cytokines, the inflammatory mediators like the reactive oxygen species, the tumor necrosis factor alpha, and the interleukin 1 beta, all these, they leads to damage of the glycocalyx layer, which leads to increase in the microvascular permeability, increased plasma fluid leakage, hence hypovolemia, then formation of interstitial edema, and then the tissue edema formation and multi-organ failure. And because of the damage of the glycocalyx layer, the endothelial cell adhesion molecules, they get exposed, and it leads to increased leukocyte and platelet attraction to the endothelium. In ischemic reperfusion injury, due to release of ANP and enzymatic degradation, glycocalyx get damaged. In case of diabetes, because of the advanced glycation end product, because of the enzymatic damage by the heparinase and the oxygen reactive oxygen species, the glycocalyx also get damaged. And in case of hypervolemia also, after fluid therapy or after cardiac, during the heart failure conditions, so because of the stretching of the ventricles, there occur release of the ANP, that is the atrial natriuretic peptide, and this ANP also cause damage to the glycocalyx. So this is the summary how in various conditions they cause damage and the shedding of the endothelial glycocalyx by releasing various mediators. So this is the normal endothelial surface layer, where the endothelium is covered by this protective jelly-like layer known as the glycocalyx, which consists of the various structural units. And here this is the cellular component exclusion zone. No leukocytes or platelet and RBC are there. But when this layer get damaged by various conditions, with various mediators like reactive oxygen species or inflammatory markers, so the endothelial cell adhesion molecules, they get exposed, and here as we can see, the leukocytes, platelet, they can come to this endothelium and attach here, leading to leukocyte adhesion and platelet aggregation. So what happens when the glycocalyx get damaged? So because of damage, there occur increased capillary permeability, which leads to loss of vascular responsiveness, interstitial edema, tissue edema. There occur impaired microcirculatory oxygen distribution. And due to the exposure of the endothelial cell adhesion molecule, the platelet aggregation and adhesion occur, which leads to formation of microthrombosis, microvascular shunting, and DIC formation. There also occur local hypercoagulability and global autoheparinization. And because of the leukocyte migration towards the endothelium, the increased leukocyte and endothelium interaction occur, which can lead to inflammation production. So as this endothelial glycocalyx layer get damaged, shedding of its structural components occur, and these components came into the plasma, so which can be used as a biomarker of glycocalyx damage. So for example, plasma level of syndecan 1, plasma level of heparin sulfate, hyaluronan, all this can be used as a biomarker of glycocalyx damage. So now we'll see how to protect this endothelial glycocalyx. So various conditions, that is use of adequate fluid, and maintaining normovolumia, maintaining normoglycemia, and adequate albumin level, serum albumin level. All this can protect the endothelial glycocalyx. Corticosteroid, because of its anti-inflammatory action, it can protect the endothelial glycocalyx. Other anti-inflammatory mediators like the TNF-alpha inhibitors like etanercept can also protect the glycocalyx layer. Antioxidants are also helpful like nitric oxide, heparin and adenosine receptor agonist. A recent review suggests that the recombinant human thrombomodulin, it protect the endothelial glycocalyx from LPS induced pulmonary injury and also helpful in preventing the formation or development of ARDS. This is because of protection of the endothelial glycocalyx. So in summary, we know that endothelial glycocalyx is a complex multi-component structure which is attached to the endothelial lumen. And now it is believed to be the primary molecular sieve for the plasma proteins. So therefore, it leads to origin of the oncotic forces which control the transcapillary fluid exchange. And this has led to a revised Starling principle. It plays a critical role in the inflammatory response cascade. It can inhibit the primary leukocyte capture and systemic leukocyte extravasation, provide a physical barrier which can regulate and localize the leukocyte recruitment to the inflamed vascularized tissue. Various conditions can lead to damage of the glycocalyx, and we have also discussed about various strategies, that is maintaining normovolumia, normoglycemia, some anti-inflammatory therapies and some newer therapies to protect the endothelial glycocalyx layer. Thank you.